So, the next speaker is Sami Haddadin, and Sami really does not need an introduction, so I'll be brief on that. His research interests span the full range from human neuromechanics and intelligence prosthetics, and he's interested in robot design and control, embodied AI to human-robot interaction, and especially robot safety, which will be part of his presentation today. Maybe just a few things. He's currently director of the Munich School of Robotics and Machine Intelligence at the University of Munich. I am not going to list the number of prizes and awards that he has won. Maybe just one is the highest German Innovation Award in 2017 that I happened to stumble over when I watched the news on television, which was very typical. And he is currently is also the chairman of the Bavarian Council on AI, and since this year, member of the German Academy of Sciences. So we are very lucky to have you here, Sami. And with that, I would give the floor to you. Thanks for accepting to speak here.
Yeah. Hi, Achim. Thanks so much for these wonderful words. And Luigi and everybody, thanks for having me here. It's a great pleasure. And it's, as always in the pandemic, it's really unfortunate that we cannot meet in person. I would have loved to see all of you and send you all my best at the moment from Garmisch-Partenkirchen, which is close to Munich. And hope to see you all soon. And thanks for pulling this together. Maybe if just someone can say okay regarding the slides and that they are showed up down.
So I see, I can see the slides and now they are also in presentation mode.
Okay, wonderful. All right. So I'll try to stick in my time. As always, this means I have to talk fast. Seems that, okay. Now it was a bit frozen, the picture, so sorry for that. Okay, so I'm going to talk about some very basic stuff today. So rather on the human side, how do we kind of understand safety in the human-robot interaction sense, meaning how can we really bring a notion of safety into the robot's understanding? And obviously this being a more fundamental question that then can obviously be spun off to all kinds of systems interacting with humans. And the fundamental idea is really to build a kind of a so-called biomechanical injury knowledge base and model that can then be leveraged from all kinds of stakeholders in the robotics pipeline, one could say. So from the design spanning to the motion planning and even cognition at some point. So this is kind of what I'm doing here. And obviously there's many more people who can really connect and contribute much more on the motion planning and prediction side. And I'll try to build this very small core that tries to be the safety core of the robots in general. And I think some of you have already stumbled over that work and maybe it's some new things that I'm trying to bring today. So a very focused one and as always, obviously a very short introduction, how did we come up with this whole idea and why is this maybe useful for robots? I mean, nowadays of today and also more and more for the autonomous systems that enter various application domains, elderly care systems were mentioned, but also in particular in industrial domain. So I think we all know that in industrial settings, still, despite there's been over the last 10 years, a heavy growth in collaborative robot systems. I think the predominant industrial robotic systems are still the classical position control devices. Let them be serial chain manipulators, parallel systems, or other hybrid approaches. However, they are typically behind safety fences. So the humans and robots are segregated and the robots are typically doing their day-to-day task. And I think we all agree that we have seen tremendous progress in the kind of field of collaborative and tactile robots. And this kind of brings me to this kind of chain of many robots. And obviously I'm super sorry for having thousands of other robots not in there, but I think what I'm trying to make a point here is really that we have been seeing a long-standing first generation robotics, mainly position control devices behind safety fences. And then more and more, we have entered this collaborative robot workspace. So the interaction, so the physical interaction to some extent became possible, opening up the question about safety of humans. Obviously something, if you go to mobile robotic systems, becomes even more clear if you have kind of joint workspaces. And then with the next generation of robots that not only can do collaboration, but really have this tactile sensitivity, do reflex controlled and very accurate control of contact forces, showing impedances in order to do assembly tests. So not only doing pick and place, but really moving to this grand challenge of robotics, the peg and hole in the real world in various applications. Then I think we have seen that the not only the collaboration has increased, but also the tactility of the systems, meaning that they can not only work next and side by side to each other, but really can form new teams that together can actually form, new manufacturing sites or new manufacturing cells, one could say, that can automate more and more the things that so far could not be automated. So not only removing the safety fences, but also opening up in new application domains that in particular with also the rise of mobility in the industrial sector that we have seen over the last decade, I think very, very interesting applications have become possible and are to come the next years. So from the torque sensing in the 80s, introduced by Wu and then kind of popularized by Bosama, and then more and more mechatronic designs at DLR and so on and so forth, that kind of went over and over from being a mere sensory or proprioceptive sensing input to really closing the loop to full tactile control, bridging, unified force impedance control to reflexes and so on and so forth. So really having this sense of touch on the proprioceptive level, commercially and readily available, which I think from a control perspective was a very important step to do. And that really laid the foundation for many of the questions that that I'm trying to tackle today and discuss. So I think we all have seen in various forms the sense of touch, the collaborative abilities to teach robots. However, I think what is extremely important again is really this notion of tactility, this notion of being able to control accurately contact forces and be able to do assembly and also sensitive insertions on an industrial grade level, which means not only in the quality and the kind of sensitivity with regard to fragile objects, but also in terms of cycle times, so that these systems really can be used in a way that they become productive and useful also to industry, which has been kind of the key component in classical first generation and also second generation automation or robotics in industry. And I think what is important really is that the sense of touch has allowed new and unforeseen kind of applications beyond collaboration. So this kind of ability to control contact forces, impedances, and also simultaneously show various patterns on this level really has kind of opening up an entirely new sector for robotics beyond the classical automation in automobile manufacturing, but really coming more and more towards the electronics, the 3C market, EMS, and so on and so forth. So all the things that really need a delicate sense of touch, but at the same time also the ability to move fast, quick, swiftly in order to execute the task at a reasonable cycle time. So these things have been opening up, and obviously they are not fully autonomous typically, but they really require the interaction with humans, especially in the teaching and the programming and the reprogramming process, which is physically by nature. And obviously, if we go more and more autonomous, obviously many of you here are really coming from the mobile robotics community, then it even becomes more important, because obviously these systems move more swiftly with the moving base and mobile manipulators, obviously adding up these two different injury sources that then could potentially harm the human in the collaboration process. So many things have been made possible, in particular in manufacturing. I was showing this already. So this has, for example, led, just to give you one use case, to the production of robots, of humans and robots to produce robots, which I think is a very interesting use case. And this was only possible because humans and robots form up a team that that we achieved to make at least as effective as doing this with only very kind of low quality labor, but in contrast to do this in Germany with technicians being trained with these robots and then being able to do the automation processes, which I think shows up the potential. Also the old dream in Europe about SMEs, robotics and SMEs, I really shows here very nicely that this is indeed possible. Obviously many steps to be taken, but in particular, one of the main challenges next to the tactility and sensitivity in the process was really this notion of collaboration. And this notion of collaboration has also, just to show you another field that I think is kind of a very borderline field that has not yet achieved attention, but I think it's kind of interesting that also in other applications beyond industry and classical surgical robots, we see this collaboration of humans and robots even in applications such as dentistry. So which I think is kind of interesting, that even in this example, which we see here, in a private practice of a dentist, robots are sometimes already being used in doing support processes and being into kind of used on a tool level with various kind of interaction abilities of the systems, not only on the cognitive side, but really also on the physical side, performing handovers of potentially dangerous tools, obviously, so sharp tools. So the interaction process here is really very kind of tightly connected to the question of this workshop, and in particular to what I want to talk about today. So the safety of humans in the collaboration process with collaborative and tactile robotic systems. So the fundamental question is, can we actually have a very basic understanding of safety that then can be used not only for the design of a robot and the control, but also for the motion generation and obviously kind of being connected to the prediction of the human motion, because obviously a potential collision, a physical collision between the two has to take both partners into account. And the fundamental questions we asked ourselves were, can a physical collision between a human and a robot be potentially dangerous at a worst case scenario? And what are the factors to be counted in order to then deduce suitable countermeasures on various levels of abstraction to then essentially make the robot safer for interaction? And we have been lucky also to be involved in the projects that were mentioned by Luigi and Achim. So Darko and Iliad, but also other European projects are kind of supporting us here, which I think really all groups around this notion of physical interaction, meaning not only the direct physical interaction, but also in the close range space. And how can we really kind of transit from the contact to the close range and have unified frameworks around this local environment around the human. So this is what all our research centers around. And I just want to give you a little bit of understanding how the thinking is and maybe what the community of motion prediction and motion planning can really benefit from in order to make their solutions fundamentally safer for human-robot interaction or even coexistence. So the fundamental question that we ask, as I said already, is what is the potential injury in the worst case? So we're not asking how can we only improve it, but first of all, so what's the boundary? How bad can it be in order to really have the worst case possible? And in particular, you want to understand it on a biomechanical level. And can we fundamentally understand this in terms of the basic robot mechanical properties, being obviously the reflected masses at the contact points, the curvatures, the local ones, surfaces respectively, the configuration, obviously, which is related to the mass, and how fast can we move given particular configurations, or how can robots move given their particular morphology? And how can we use this knowledge, if we understand it, to make our design better, our control more safer, and in particular, the planning also more safer? Because obviously, this is something that we should consider, especially in the close interaction of humans and robots, and the more even on the mobility case than maybe even on the stationary robot case. So there is a kind of fundamental differentiation that comes along with it. There is the global versus the local perspective, I think. So we all understand that the motion or the local motion and the control are really more like a local perspective of safety. So it's like the speed limit, one could say, locally. And then there is the speed map, we could call it, regarding the planning problem, regarding the design problem. So how can we change the global properties of the robot such that we can really move very nicely and safely? So lots of this understanding comes from impact data. So we collided many years ago all kinds of robots against dummies, and try to understand how do these mechanical interactions play along and how can we measure safety in these particular environments. So some of the things we have been doing back then, obviously, and I always like to show this video because this was kind of a very interesting experiment at night when I tried to understand, so what happens really in the worst case. I switched off all the safety collision thresholds and tried to see, is this robot really as safe as we hoped it to be? And interestingly, it was able or it was not able to damage, at least not tremendously, the forehead in this example. And I think what is kind of interesting with this is that this kind of has a kind of analogy especially in autonomous in car industry. So where the basic understanding of human injury was really important to make the cars as safe as they have become today. And in autonomous driving, we all know that the main differentiator and the thing that gets attention is really the injury of humans. So we can see this with Tesla and all the accidents that have been happening. that the human injury is really of prime importance also for general society and public. So we really need to take this very, very seriously in order to make robots as safe as it can be. And this has also been for more than 15 years now, our research. Can we, part of our research, can we understand this safety between the collision properties of a robot, the human injury that might occur, and obviously the human state, including its motion state, are fundamental to this understanding. So I think what is kind of clear is that we first need to understand, so how does human injury occur? And let's take two examples. Obviously, this is maybe almost an obvious statement. It depends on the collision or collided body part. Obviously, the head and the chest in automobile industry, for example, are the main and vital parts that are important for this idea. However, what was always the problem in human injury measurements and data in the literature, in the kind of biomechanics, injury, and forensic literature, was always that there was not one unified representation. And we kind of, over many years, elaborated on that and tried to bring everything into a physically interpretable interpretation that, especially in robotics, we can bridge to. And a robot is a mechanical system. So for us as robotics engineers, I think it's kind of obvious that mass and velocity would be the right kind of axis of understanding, because a mass collides with the velocity at the human body part, and then we would like to understand the injury, is it subcritical or overcritical? So knowing that humans typically respond in a threshold level to injury. And what we have found is really, we went through all kinds of literature, thousands and thousands of articles over 70 years of biomechanics research, and kind of put together, and this is just a very tiny part of it, all the safety data that is available into so-called safety curves, so mass velocity plots, in which we can now see that there is a clear threshold for particular kind of collisions in humans that span this mass velocity plot. Obviously, one could argue for energies, for momentum, and so on and so forth, but we will soon see why mass and velocity are the right choices of these axes, because we can then control really and use that knowledge for motion planning and velocity shaping, which we obviously need to do in robotics. So fundamental for this is obviously that how do we connect this representation now to robotics? Then there's an obvious choice. We all know that from Osama's fantastic seminal work in the 80s. So the so-called reflected mass representation of the Lagrangian dynamics that we have in robotics into an instantaneous representation that kind of takes into account the respective collision vector U, the inertial dynamics on an operational space level via the Jacobian mapped, and then it's kind of an instantaneous property. So we cannot change MU anyways, given that we have a robot instantaneously. So given a certain joint state Q, same thing for mobile systems, the same thing for humanoids, any kind of robotic system has an instantaneous mass property in a specific collision direction given a specific collision point. So obviously the endpoint could be interesting to us. So now the next question would be, can we actually understand how fast can we move in this potentially dangerous collision direction? And then obviously try to connect this to the human injury data that we just saw and see where do they intersect? And so basically telling, given a robot at that initial properties with this kind of contact geometry, that's the maximum velocity it might be able to move given that that body part to be impacted in, which obviously relies heavily on the human motion observation or estimation and prediction. So this is obviously where we assume that you guys are really doing a great job and giving us the right information for estimating the right points that are to be respected. Obviously, you can always do a worst case assumption, take the worst case, but obviously this would reduce the performance of a robot quite substantially. So what does this mean on a kind of a unified representation level? So the idea is essentially that the same that we do for robotics. So we bring our kind of global or instantaneous representation of mass velocity. Obviously, this can span an entire set of space along the mass and the velocity spaces. We can kind of sweep over the entire, let's say, configuration space. We know this is big, however, it's possible. And then the same thing could obviously be done for the human. And then we can essentially intersect these fundamental injury spaces of the human, which are represented in mass velocity space, to the dynamic space of the robot and intersect them and therefore have a computationally very efficient representation on which we can now plan, design, control, and obviously plan motions in particular. Okay, so and what is important, however, is that I did one fundamental assumption that we know how to compute the reflected inertias, which is very important in robotic dynamics, especially in impacts with humans. And there's lots of current standards that have been kind of released over the years, in particular about collaborative robots. There's also some notion now about mobility and so on and so forth. So motion prediction is a very important aspect here. However, what is extremely important is that there has been a major simplification in these standards. They tried to basically suggest in this ISO TS 15066 that the reflected mass of a robot can basically be computed as a sum of the link segments, of the robot segments, and then dividing this essentially by half. This is kind of a rule of thumb that they introduced. However, especially in articulated robots, we know that this would produce extreme, and I say extreme, oversimplifications and therefore reduction in performance of the systems, which obviously for motion planning and in particular for human motion prediction would pose a severe limitation. So what can we do? We have kind of tried to see how does this really reflect the real world robots, such like a lightweight robot or a panda system. And what we see is that the TS essentially overestimates the reflected mass of the KUKA lightweight robot basically all the time and by quite some margin, obviously depending on the particular configuration. And the same, even worse, can be seen for the panda, where we see that for only a marginal number of poses compared to the total poses, the reflected inertia is essentially on that level that was proposed by the ISO TS 15066. So obviously there has to be some substantial improvement. However, the math and the dynamics is very clear. Obviously the reflected inertias are the ones that are to be taken into account in order to really do that. And we are kind of at the moment in interaction with the respective experts to kind of see how we can insert this knowledge into the respective standards. So what is kind of important now is, I guess, how do we really make this useful? And so let's have a look at the local versus the global perspective on the safety motion problem. So I think what is kind of now clear is that given that we would have an injury analysis and this particular collision model coming from the injury data in the literature, we can now obviously, by understanding the mass, velocity, and curvature, kind of compute a safe instantaneous velocity that a robot would be able to move, that even in a collision with a human, that would be happening, subcritical collisions would occur. So absolutely safe in terms of all safety data that you have available. The same thing would also apply for pain data or any other kind of respective data. We are currently right now showing it also for kind of cognitive level of safety functions. So what does this mean? Instantaneously, we're essentially just evaluating the robot reflected mass at the instantaneous configuration Q, and then compute the safe velocity given all the set of safety curves that might span the different contact points, the different body parts, and then take the most conservative one or the closest one, obviously depending on the kind of prediction and estimation accuracy of the human observation module. So a potential implementation on the worst case level just takes a motion planner, computes a robot trajectory, and then shapes essentially according to the safety threshold. So this is kind of a module that can be inserted after any kind of motion planner. So it doesn't depend on the motion planning itself. It just shapes the desired velocity that you compute from the motion planning process and tells you basically now you can only, it's like a speed limit that is dynamically evaluating depending on Q, so the state of the system, and depending on the particular relation of the human and the robot in the particular space. So I'm just showing you a super naive example. Human and robot, they are being tracked here with a camera that has been developed by Achim's team in the Tenua, a spin-off from his lab, where we have kind of combined the human motion measurement and the SMU. And what you could see here now in the beginning is that the robot is now, when the human is coming, is shaping its velocity according to the injury that is kind of stored in the injury database. And as soon as the human removes or kind of de-enters the workspace, the robot again then moves at non-safe critical speed. So obviously assuming that you can have a safe separation between the human and the robot. So, and this can be connected to arbitrarily complex scenarios. At the moment, we're kind of doing experiments on mobile manipulator systems. So, and then if we now go to the global perspective, which is especially important for motion planning, so what's the cost function, what's the loss function that we could use for all kinds of planning or learning problems even, then obviously we need to span the entire geometric space, so the whole configuration space of the system, and then sweep essentially. And what we see here is just to show for two different robots, the Puma and the lightweight robot, that the dynamic spaces of these robots spanning over the geometric, so the configuration in this particular example, if they have no kind of dangerous end effectors attached, cannot exceed the potential injury that has been measured by cadaver or human experiments in the literature. So this kind of shows that on a global perspective, these robots, if you look at the entire configuration space, can only span a certain kind of area in the mass velocity space, and this doesn't intersect with injury data, then by design, these robots would not be dangerous. Obviously, this kind of depends on the velocity that, and by the way, this is the relative velocity between human and robot. So obviously, this kind of is a measurement that is relative to the human speed. Okay, and also one important point, especially in manipulation, mobile manipulation, is we need to be able to be flexible with end effectors that grasp objects. Obviously, they change the inertial properties of the system, but we don't want to recompute everything. So also what we have been working on is, can we essentially have these representations of the human and robot relative dynamics be extended by the concept of essentially the end effector dynamics, but with additive, so kind of extremely reusable code that then can basically use the dynamics and the reflected inertias from a robot that is moving, and then also a robot that has been grasping objects, and then essentially have an incremental framework that then can essentially kind of do this on a level that the dynamics can be efficiently computed in real time. So here we see one example for a Puma 560 just doing a pick and place task. And what we can now see here is that we sample the space. There is this typical configuration, which is basically that movement here in the mass velocity space. And now what we can see is that we can now essentially online shift the properties of this area depending on the center of mass of the payload. And this is, I think, a very important property, because this makes it possible to also use this framework, not only on planning, but also online during manipulation, by essentially updating the safety curves online, or the safety maps, as we call them, if they are global, in order to then really produce fully safe motions, given all this injury and dynamics data of the robot. So we are right now actually putting together a paper that kind of generalizes to this, even to mobile manipulators and humanoids. So this kind of scales really nicely, and essentially is a very efficient method to kind of combine dynamics also, which obviously is important for the motion in close interaction with humans. So this is something, as I just said, we kind of are now scaling to all kinds of systems, really going up to non-holonomic arbitrary vehicles with payloads, and also humanoids, which is something we have been recently doing, but still not published. Okay, so the last thing I want to talk about very quickly, because I know there's many talks about that, I wanted to put focus on this very specific safety module, because I think this might be interesting to various motion planning and prediction and human motion prediction modules, because this is kind of the input to that module in some sense, is obviously, can we use that knowledge also in control and planning? Yes, we can, together with Matej Hoffmann and his student Peter Swarny at CTU, we have been working, and Desh Mohammed Zariakan in my lab, we have been working on, can we essentially encode this motion knowledge into a phase-based planning? Obviously, this can also be generated to others kind of systems, and the experiment here is really showing that this injury knowledge or proximity can be combined, not only in the worst case, but also with proximity knowledge, with human motion tracking, obviously, where various kind of optimalities can be shown. So depending on the closeness and depending on the intended motion, which is obviously important for the collision directions, this kind of reactive behavior can be used to then respond also more to the human motion estimation and simplified prediction. So this is a very simplified planning process we're doing here, just kinematic and with just showing the principle. And the nice thing is, now the more knowledge you put into that, the more efficient you can be. What I've been talking about so far was mainly worst case, but if you now take into consideration some very basic predictions, then the nice thing is that you not only optimize over the reflected inertia, which is still a rather conservative process, but with the motion prediction, you can now start to make the systems extremely efficient and really take into consideration whether a foreseeable incident will happen or not, and therefore obviously use this in the planning process, even on the most simple level, such as phase-based motion planning, which I think is a very important aspect in order to really kind of make sure that the safety does not sacrifice all the performance. And then also by comparing local prediction that basically just looks at the velocity direction and then also some prognosis windows that try to take into consideration where the human will be in the future, then we can really kind of have as quite efficient motion planning that becomes more and more applicable also to the real world. And just the last video I brought you is now a video that tries to put everything together. So a human worker that collaborates with a robot, or in fact with two robots, and then a human kind of estimation and prediction system that then tries to use these robots in an efficient manner, however safe. So the SMU basically being on the ground, and then these local predictions and prognosis windows that we just talked about are kind of being used in these in these manufacturing processes. So very simple processes like filing or also polishing, we will see in the next one. So here we can see how the proximity of the human slows down the system. Here now comes a second process. So we see the teaching process, so the physical interaction, then starting that interaction and showing that depending on the proximity, which we will see in a second, after the system has been taught. And now depending on the proximity of the human, which we see now here, I hope so. Yeah, so now the robot slows down, obviously, to a safe interaction and can be interrupted while it's working, fenceless, and complying with all the kind of safety standards, you could say, and all the SMU calculation that we have been showing so far. Yeah, and this kind of scales also nicely, as I said, to mobile systems, something we're right now working on and hopefully kind of connecting to the great work that we're going to see today. And I would like to thank very much all the funding agencies that have been supporting this work, and would like to conclude my talk. And thanks a lot for the attention.
Thank you very much, Sami. Very nice presentation. And since we have only a few minutes, I checked the participants list whether there are questions. Please raise your hand or just speak up if that's possible for you. While I don't see a question there at the moment, I was just wanted to ask, you showed these safety curves that are used then by the safe motion unit, and I was wondering, based on the biomechanic injury data, and I was wondering how that would adapt to the state of a person. For example, if we are thinking about homes for the elderly and people who suffer from osteoporosis, would that be just a scaling, or
That's a great question, because it's actually quite a complex process, I guess, as we all would foresee. So first of all, there is something that I hide always by just looking at these local perspectives. First of all, saying, it's really the human state, as you say, and just on the motion state already, that kind of is quite complex, and where the motion estimation and prediction gets into place. And the second one is exactly as you say, beyond the fact that due to your own motion, the respective body parts that are in danger are changing dynamically, obviously, which is quite a complex process if you compare it to these, autonomous mobile or autonomous driving scenarios we know, which are rather global on the human sense. And then similar to what has been done in automobile crash testing and injury analysis, exactly what you say now is important for which individuals are we kind of building these systems. And the safety curves are only known on a large scale for, let's say, the 50th or 95th percentile of humans. And they have been great research over 70 years, but still not to all the corner cases that are obviously important in robotics. So we have not the same requirements in robotics as we have in automobile crash testing. So obviously there is the need for being conservative as much as possible. Luckily, especially in the home, and especially if it comes to elderly, if it comes to also people with certain limitations and diseases, speed is not anymore the notion of quality. So we can be much, much slower, and we can now even move towards pain. So this is a kind of a different representation you could use. There is also, interestingly, from care sciences and caretakers know that quite well, what are the right forces and interaction forces to collaborate and interact with these people. And the The presumable way I would take is probably to teach them from the caretaker so that the robot actually understands what the right forces and interactions are. And then it's kind of implicitly coded. So the data is generated from the expert, not necessarily from, let's say, the injury data, as in my example. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. There's a question in the audience. Anna?
Yes. Sorry, here is Anna Manucci from Örebro University. And yes, I have a question. I'd like to ask if you see any challenge, and which are actually the challenges in porting this SMU unit into vehicles, because we have seen a lot of examples showing this with the robotic arms, not many examples showing the same with the vehicles. But I know that there are some work in this direction. So really the question is, where are the difficulties that we have to overcome in porting this technology into vehicles?
Yeah, it's a great question, because this is exactly what we have been working on for the last years, to show that this can also be ported to essentially arbitrary systems. And the main challenge to answer this question first is to find a representation that has similar properties to the representations in stationary robots, because they are very nice for computational reasons. And obviously the question of about holonomic, non-holonomic is really fundamental there. But the nice thing is that you can find a representation in which you can solve it with a holonomic system, and then find a transformation essentially. That's exactly what we are right now in the process of publishing or submitting that paper, to be honest. The interesting thing is that this case collapses to the stationary, obviously, one could say, for infinite mass of the vehicle. So if the vehicle case is even simpler than the one we show here, but it's more dangerous, obviously, because typically they are faster. If you have a kind of a vehicle in an industrial motion states, then they are typically beyond 1 meter per second. In collaborative spaces, you need to reduce. That's first thing. And the other thing is really on the dynamics level, but this I think is rather now almost solved problem, because I think this is exactly what we're going to publish soon. And the important thing there is, however, the holonomy aspect that really makes it a little bit special, but also then in the end interesting to solve. And maybe one more thing, if I may. What is maybe the also a very relevant question, if you go from stationary to mobile systems, is that the human body parts are different that you need to consider. So the feet, the lower limbs are very important if you go to mobile systems in these collaborative scenarios, because in contrast to cars, you have different potential kind of risk states. So especially your feet are in danger, right? Or your shins, or these kind of things, and not so much your hands, right? And interestingly, if you go for insurances and so on, the hands are obviously quite valuable. There's different ways of rating also the body parts. That's maybe even the more closer you go to real world deployment, the more you also have to consider this kind of question. So kind of three answers, hopefully, that answer well the question from different perspectives.
Okay, thanks very much. We have a tough timeline, so we need to move to the next speaker. Thanks again, Sami. And I, with this, I would